94 divided in French. He finished the university in French in 1964, and after he was a doctor fellow in Princeton University, and after a resident associate Princeton University too. From in 1964, he joined to the National Center for Scientific Research, CNRS, and from in research from 1975, he professor at university at Madame Curie, Paris, France. He gets different honors, for instance, in 1972, Bathurst Foundation Award in the Netherlands, and she was invited professor in different countries. Recently, he is the president of the European Federation of Catalysis Society and member of the Academy Europea. Professor Xi was elected vice president of the Council of the International Congress of Catalysis at the last meeting of the Council. His scientific activity is the following. Professor Xi works in the field of surface reactivity in relation to heterogeneous catalysis. The main object is to enlarge concepts which can help in understanding activity and selectivity of catalytic materials and designing more efficient catalysts. The emphasis of his research is on application of the coordination mechanism theory to produce systems control transmitted ions for 64 interactions, which can serve as a precursor of supported mono or bimetallic catalytic materials. His research activity has led to about 200 applications of the future. I ask Professor Xi to deliver his lecture. Interfacial modulation chemistry process and neural catalysis.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, for your nice introduction. Before starting, I would like to dedicate this lecture to four people who are talking about Professor John Tkiewicz, Dr. Claude Nakash, and the late Dr. Tench. Mr. Chairman, ladies and gentlemen, I wish to express my gratitude to the organizers of this Congress for giving me the opportunity and honor to present this lecture today in order for you to understand the change of title, for which I do apologize. I would like to show you the first part of the contents, the field of interfacial coordination chemistry and the approach to study it. So in preparing this lecture, it became increasingly clear to me that a large part of the molecular aspect of catalyst design refers to those compounds, largely organometallics, which are deposited onto the support and to the so-called surface organomechanic chemistry, as shown now on the right part of this slide. I do apologize if it's not very clear. By contrast, the molecular aspect of the support is far less understood, particularly during catalyst preparation, involving both liquid-solid and gas-solid interfaces. This is this field, interfacial coordination chemistry, that I want to consider now. I must admit that it was tempting to take the ICC symbol that you can see on both sides of this lecture room. Let us look now at the specificities of these two fields. Now, on the left-hand side, you have interfacial coordination chemistry, which refers to high oxidation state of the metal part the ligands are normally weak ligands in terms of the crystal field theory and composed essentially of chlorine, oxide, water, ammonia, essentially those ligands which are used in catalyst preparation methods. The interaction between the metal and the ligands are rather ionic and are described in terms essentially of the crystal fields and lately of molecular orbital. Therefore, the application, because the ligands are slightly perturbed, are basically catalyst preparation and selective ion absorption. By contrast, surface organometallic chemistry, which has been well documented, refers to low metal oxidation state, even though recently high oxidation state has been described. And by organometallic chemistry, one refers, of course, to those compounds where there is a metal carbon bond, at least one. And the ligands are sigma donor pi acceptor in comparison with the sigma donor pi donor in the first field. And interactions between the metal and the ligand are rather covalent and described therefore by molecular orbital. This has led to a number of groups to predict stability and the reactivity of such compounds. Because the ligands are perturbed, the application is rather on the organic synthesis side and catalysis side. Now, when one tries to survey the literature on interfacial coordination chemistry, immediately two enormous questions arise. First is the role of the oxide support, and second, how can we probe and control ion support interactions? Now, the answer to those questions require to have suitable probes, and it just happened that transition metal ions, which are very often catalytic sites, can be used as their own probe to follow the change occurring in their environment during the various steps of their lives. Because they have partly 5d orbitals, any change will affect the magnetic and optical properties, which can be followed by adequate spectroscopy. Now, if you add other structural techniques, like X-rays, local ones, we are now in a position at least to try to answer these two basic questions. Before going into see how fruitful these probes can be, I just would like to make a little survey of earlier studies in interfacial coordination chemistry. Sorry again for the slide, probably you won't see it in the back. I would like to emphasize that there have been a few papers, but very important papers, which have really put interfacial coordination chemistry on its way. I think the first I consider very important, in 1960, at the International Conference of Catalysis in Paris, Dowden and Wells proposed to apply crystal field theory to a catalysis phenomenon. 3 years later, Abel and Cohn jumped on this idea and showed that for the oxygen nickel oxide system, the nickel bulk coordination could be partially or completely restored upon desorption. 2 years later, Bowen, Haller, and co workers really started now what I would describe. The field where you try to see how one complex can get bonded to the surface. And they did show that in certain conditions for this compound, where you have a planar ethylene diamine ligands with two chloride ions, that by an exchange of chloride with the SiO minus ligand from the surface, it would attach and therefore show that the surface was a monodentate ligand. A couple of, well, 4 years later, Appel and Lewis, in a beautiful paper, showed that silica could act also as bi- and tridentate ligand. And finally, even though it's not precisely fully coordination chemistry, at least it gave a tremendous insight on how we could rationalize the results. That was made by the French person Brunel. How we could rationalize the absorption in electrostatic terms of complexes onto inorganic oxides. So let's move to point number three now on the concept of interfacial coordination chemistry. chemistry. Now, I do apologize again for the next slide, you won't see it very well, but it doesn't matter. All I'm interested in here is to show that when you start to have a complex in solution, a metal ion surrounded by the first coordination sphere of ligands, and then the second sphere by a solvation sphere composed of solvent molecules. Now, what we're interested in is to follow this arrow and see how we can, in fact, control the interaction between this complex with this oxide surface. So therefore, from now on, I'm going to consider complexes in interaction with an oxide surface. And it's likely that this can be extended to other types of support, namely sulfides and so forth. Now, what I'm going to show is once in solution you can approach the surface, if it's covered by OH groups, you can have a weak interaction, physical interaction of the van der Waals type or slightly stronger hydrogen bonding between the OH groups and the ligands. But now what we're after is to look for something which is stronger. Now, how can we manage to have this complex be stuck to the surface? And this is where we go back to the paper by Pinel, who applied ideas of Cox, published in Chemical Review in 1965, which was giving for an oxide immersed in a solvent, a particular pH called isoelectronic point. And this isoelectronic point is the pH at which the concentration of positive charge species and negatively charged species are equal. If this is the case, then the pH is called the isoelectronic point. So that when you boil this pH, the surface becomes negatively charged, and here you have an SO- surface, charged surface. While if you're below this isoelectronic point, conversely, the surface becomes positively charged. Therefore, it means that you have a kind of capacitor plate onto which the ion slowly move and are attracted by electrostatic absorption. Therefore, the first point I want to make that the pH on the solid side can be used as a selection switch to select, in fact, the surface charge that you wish. Now, if one wants to remove a positively charged species adsorbed onto the surface, which would be negatively charged, of course it's interesting to wash, for instance, at a pH which would charge the surface positively, therefore removing it by electrostatic expulsion any formally adsorbed species. So we've seen so far here a qualitative parameter which will be able to switch between positive and negative at will. Now there's something more subtle than that, and this is shown in the next slide, where now we have a quantitative aspect. Now let's look at the delta potential curves, particularly here for silica, that we're going to use further in the following. Now, if you look at these delta potential curves, they just indicate quantitatively the number of sites which are present onto the surface. When the zeta potential is negative, it means that the surface acquires charged negative species on the surface, so the surface becomes negatively charged. But you can see that you have to go to a pH around 6 to have substantial increase of this concentration. Now, when you are on the positive side, it means that you get a concentration of positively charged sites. Now this is interesting because it shows that you not only have to select the correct pH to select the correct surface charge, but you have also to realize that you need to have enough sites to glue the transition metal ion complex. Now, so much for the solid side. What happens now on the liquid side? On the liquid side, here again, the pH will be very important in selecting the type of complex that you can have in solution. Now, for instance, if you are at high pH, you will have essentially, for instance, in the case of copper, this tetraamine copper 2+ complex. But if you decrease the pH, you will be we starting to have mixed complex and replacement of the ammonia molecules by water. So therefore, now not only you have two parameters, still the pH on the solid side, quantitative and qualitative, but you also have something on the liquid side which will trigger the type of interaction that you can select. Now let's see how we can move from electrostatic adsorption. Now when we have here a negatively surface charge, you can stick the complex onto the surface, but you realize that the metal center in the middle of the complex is electrostatically added onto the surface, but it's screened by the first coordination sphere, the liquids. Now I would like to concentrate on the silica-supported nickel system, and in this case, if one uses the UV visible near-infrared reflectance spectroscopy, diffuse reflectance, one can, for any nickel, which is in optical coordination, expect three bands. So as long as we see three bands, it means that the coordination will be octahedral, and with weak ligands, it's a strong normally nickel with a square planar symmetry. Now let's see what happens now when one puts in the beaker, for instance, at the pH of the order of 10, where the essential complex is this hexa-aline complex. Now if you dip into this solution, silica, you can quickly see that the silica is becoming magenta. The purple blue solution, color of the solution, slightly fades away. And it means, in fact, because the UV spectra are identical, that, in fact, because of the concentration of color that the nickel examinees stuck onto the surface by electrostatic adsorption. Now, nothing will happen if you don't lower the pH by washing. You can wash out the pH and start to do something within the coordination sphere of this nickel exam. Nothing is going to happen for the simple reason that ammonia is a non-bridging ligand. The lone pair of electrons is bonded to the metal center. There is no any other electron pairs to make any other bond. Now if you, on the other hand, decrease the pH, then you have within this adult species something which will not, can be not observed, but quickly you have a replacement of ammonia by water. And water now is a weaker ligand and is instantaneously replaced by the surface ligand. So therefore the nickel here is now directly into the contact of the surface. So you have iono covalent ligand interaction, and that is of course far more stronger. Now when you continue to wash with decreasing pH, now you successively remove these two ammonia remaining by water, and you end up with something with four molecules of water and these two silica entering into the coordination sphere. So therefore here, the oxide surface is really acting as a bidentate supramolecular ligand. And the surface that we have, the surface complex that we have here, becomes neutral because you have two positively charged here and two negative here. And you are in presence of a mixed ligand complex with, in fact, rigid ligands and mobile ligands here. Now, of course, this cis geometry would be preferred because of the plane of the surface. And the driving force for having such interaction is that you have a chelate effect, which is an entropy-driven reaction. Of course, as soon as here the water is repelled and goes into the gas, into the liquid phase, you have this surface ligand coming in. Therefore, you have an increase of disorder because you're removing two water ligands and you have only one species remaining onto the surface. So it's an entropy-driven reaction as exactly coordination chemistry. Now, this is the conclusion which are derived by the analysis of this UV spectra. You can see here that through all the process A, B, C, and D, where we are making the experiments I was describing before, ion exchange and then washing the solution of decreasing pH, you have these 1, 2, and 3 bands indicating that you remain in orthogonal symmetry. Now, in the near infrared region here, one can look at the presence of the ligands, and you can see that the ammonia ligands shown by these two bands disappear, because at the end you have the complex citrus surface by two bidentate bonds. Now you also see that throughout these processes, you see that there is a bathochromic shift going towards lower energy. You see that, for instance, if you take this new 3 band, you can really see that the shift towards into that this direction to lower energy, showing that you have a decreased electrostatic field experienced by nickel. Now, it's very complicated to see. Now, I'm claiming that silica is becoming a supramolecular ligand. Now, how far can we go into this analogy? And can we answer the question, can we locate this ligand within the spectrochemical series? And the answer is yes. How can we do that? Now, we have to apply the so-called rule of average environment, which means that when you're replacing in this hexamine ligand, one ammonia molecule by water. Now, if you're doing that, we know what the new 3 band is, and you have the two energy related to these two complexes. And if you take the difference in energy divided by 6, when you're replacing one ammonia by one water, it means that you have a downward field of 480 reciprocal centimeters. So it means that water, because of negative downward field, is weaker than ammonia. Likewise, we can do the same thing. And now we observe that there is also when one replaces water by this SiO minus, looking at these two reference compounds, one we have produced and here that you can take from the literature, is that again when you replace water by SiO minus, you have also a downward shift field. Which means that silica here, SiO minus, is weaker than water and weaker than ammonia. And the reason for this is that simply if you consider the electronic structure of this O minus bonding with the nickel, in fact, there is one lone pair which is pointing along the metal ligand direction, and you have two pi orbitals which are perpendicular to giving this pi donor character to this ligand here. And the sigma donor, pi donor, are known to be on the left-hand side of the spectrochemical series and are therefore weak ligands. Now, why it is important to know what type of ligand is the surface? Simply because when you know, if you take in the redox potential, for instance, of this iron-3-iron-3 couple, by changing the nature of the ligand surrounding the ion, then you can alter the redox potential. So therefore, it's very important to know, likewise, if one replaces this water by silica ligand, how it will affect. So now, this is something that people are trying to do, and it's likely that in the future, some more quantitative aspects will emerge from those studies. Now, I've concentrated now, we have just passed from electrostatic adsorption here to really something which is grafted, and the interaction is much stronger. Now what I want to do is show that one can move from model 4 to model 5 when one removes all this liquid phase. And here one tries to go into something which is interesting because one is able to create now an unknown situation in coordination chemistry, namely that you can produce vacant sites here, which will be the driving force for adsorption and catalysis. Now, on the next slide, you can see that by dynamic thermal treatment in oxygen to keep the oxidation state constant, you can now remove all the ligands one by one and move from a 6 to 5 coordinated species. Here, the nickel was bonded to 2 terminal longitude. Now, one water is going away, and this nickel now gets bonded to this bridging oxygen so that the surface now becomes from bidentate tridentate supramolecular ligand. one can continue to do that, and one goes from the four coordinated to the three coordinated state. And here we are in a position where the nickel is no longer bonded to some mobile ligand, but only to the surface, two times oxygen and one oxygen. And this is a very specific aspect to interfacial coordination chemistry. Now, I've described so far what could happen looking at the solid side and liquid side. Now, there's something which I haven't mentioned. I've mentioned already three roles assigned to the pH. Now, there's a fourth one, namely that the silica now can dissolve. And again, it's another molecular aspect that one considers, that the silica can produce by dissolution, and it's very interesting to see that there is almost no dissolution in this pH range from 0 to 6, but again here, at pH 6, one sees a dramatic increase of solubility, which is in fact exactly what is required if you want to have enough exchange sites. So therefore, it's a dramatic situation, because when you want to do ion exchange and have enough exchange site, you also start to remove monomers from the surface, and therefore you have to, when I say monomer, you can see that the silica here, this is the surface of silica, is approached by these hydroxide ions. And what happens that you can produce new OH groups, and this is one monomer going into the liquid phase. Now you have a kind of depolarization, so that surface here can be considered as a reservoir of molecular entities which can be by depolarization released into the liquid phase. Now if we do that, obviously we come into the salt gel field, whereby you can create inorganic solids from molecular precursors. And now in solution, if you have monomers of one type and monomers of the other type, carrying OH or water, then you can have hydroxy bridge formation, and this is a process called olation. The same thing is happening with oxolation, except that here you're producing one oxygen bridging ligand. And very important to realize that this oxygen and OH groups are bridging ligands. Now, if you want to avoid this type of now copolymerization between, let's say, the solution monomers, transition metal complexes, and those released by the support. Now one has to stop that type of interaction. Now the way to do that is to put these two phenomena out of phase, and one can do that, and I've given here an example where one can look at XF experiments. One can, at a pH of 9.8, that is 1.8 missing, so it's a pH about 10. Well, the silica can dissolve, but then you can protect the nickel, so the monomer in solution on the transition side, by ammonia or ethylene diamine, which both are non-bridging ligands. And here you can see there is no silica oxygen nickel bonds possible, and therefore you will remain in electrostatic adsorption. On the other hand, if you are at the pH range where the silica is less soluble, but then you open a gate into the complexes, create grid points because water can be a bridging ligand, then you can start to have this copolymerization between support monomers and transition metal complexes forming SiO nickel bonds and forming silicates. Now, this can be shown by XAS. You can see that the first coordination here refers to oxygen and ammonia ligand, and second here for water ligand, and the second coordination sphere is composed here of nickel and silica, attesting that here one forms silicates. When instead when using ammonia ligands or ethylene diamine to avoid this process, this second piece is completely absent. So again here it shows that the support has a molecular aspect in releasing molecular species. Now, I concentrated on ion exchange, but the same can happen on grafting. And in this case, another type of molecular aspect which is provided by the support, namely through its functional OH groups. And if you do that, you can have a kind of stoichiometry reaction producing this vanadyl exposed bonding into the surface, pointing out towards the surface and releasing three hydrogen chloride molecules. Now, I think this is as much as I want to say on catalyst preparation. There are a number of other preparations like this, and you can see that in the written paper. But because of the time, I now move on to the fourth part, namely transition metal ions, adsorption, and catalytic sites. And I will start by considering now adsorption sites, and I take the case of model 6, which represents here ions which are at the surface, but part of the framework. Now, I would like to draw the analogy again to show that the surface has a strong molecular behavior in showing what happens here when one considers synthetic oxygen carriers. Now, these synthetic oxygen carriers are made up of cobalt tubes surrounded by square planar demanding ligands like thalocyanin, porphyrin, or sheath bases. And below you have the Lewis space, which will be able to control the absorption, the oxygen absorption capacity of this cobalt to stabilize the superoxide ion by electron transfer. And so you have an equilibrium here, and you can shift from left to right by increasing the oxygen and lowering the temperature, or go backwards by decreasing the oxygen pressure or increasing the temperature. Now, one can follow by infrared the new OO stretching bond vibration here, the nature of this species. It can be also followed by ESR. And one can even look at the angle here using oxygen 17 and rich oxygen. And all this has been done using, in fact, cobalt oxide, magnesium oxide solid solution. I thought the slide could be clear enough to indicate that if I take this cobalt 2 plus in the face of the magnesium 100 surface plane, it's surrounded by four oxide ions into the surface, and below the block, here you have a dashed line, represents the kind of Lewis space I was talking earlier on. And this cobalt 2 plus has exactly the same behavior and can function as a synthetic oxygen carrier. Now, if you look at this cobalt magnesium neighboring pair, you can cycle in a tonal cycle just by playing on the tensor and the pressure of oxygen. You can circle in a loop and reversibly absorb oxygen. In the laboratory of Elio Giannello, and also this is a paper referring to co-authored with Zekina and some Polish people, Krishna Direk and Sojka, we've been able to go around this loop several tens of times. And it does again show that the surface can really be acting as a molecular species. Now, I said earlier on adsorption site and catalytic site, I would like to show here an example, again, how the surface can function in a similar way as, let's say, an homogeneous catalysis. Now, if you reduce the previous nickel, the last one I was showing after thermal treatment, do you remember there was a nickel 2 plus bonded to three surface oxygen, two terminal and one bridging oxygen. Now, if you reduce that carefully under hydrogen at very low temperature, let's say 150 degrees, you can develop now an ESR signal, which is assigned to nickel plus, which is a 3E9 ion, like copper, and can be studied by ESR. Now, if one adsorbs carbon monoxide onto that species, one can go, by increasing the pressure, go to a successive series of monocarbonyl nickel plus, dicarbonyl, tricarbonyl, and tetracarbonyl species, where, in fact, again, it can be reversibly performed. You increase the seal pressure and you move from mono D3 tetracarbon and go backward. Now, I'm not going to describe that because it's not catalytic, it's just the absorption. Here, I want to concentrate on the catalytic side. Now, if I start with this dicarbonyl, which happens to be planar, and in saying that, you can see that by absorbing carbon monoxide, I can remove one mole from the surface, so that surface now from tree becomes tree dentate. You can see the mobility of the protoplast species. And now if I take the species and start to play with it, I can try to perform absorption of ethylene. Now if I do that at low pressure, I can see that I can form this mixed complex with these two oxide ions from the surface. Now you have these two carbon monoxide entities who are still present. But here one has added one ethylene molecule to have a trigonal bipyramid complex. The long axis is here. At perpendicular to this long axis, you have in the equatorial plane one oxide ion and two mobile ligands, CO and ethylene. Now, if you look at the catalytic site, if you introduce ethylene and you analyze the products after 24 hours, there is no reaction at all. Now, if you increase the pressure of ethylene, now you can see that this carbon monoxide can be removed. And now in the equatorial plane, you have two ethylene molecules. And here, again, you have a trigonal bipyramid with the nickel plus in the center. And after 24 hours, then you see that there is no longer a monomer, and you have essentially a diamond in the form of 1-butene, trans-butene, and 2-cis-butene. Now, the selectivity can be changed, particularly if one takes some bulky alkyl phosphines. And if I replace, for instance, this CO by some alkyl phosphine which are much bulkier, then one can start to play on the transformation of these two ethylene molecules into the dimers. If I do that, then I can have, for instance, here, this is a metal center, and then you have this alkyl phosphine with the phosphorus here at the center, and so that defines what is called the cone angle, which can be varied depending on the nature of the phosphine. Well, it just happened that if you are taking ethyl phosphine ligands, you can now change the selectivity and reverse what was before here essentially a low selectivity in 1-butene to something which is around 95% into only 1-butene, and you get very little of the trans-2-butene. So it means that the dimerization of ethylene taken in the probe reaction indicates that one has to consider now four types of ligand around the metal center. You have the rigid surface ligand here, which is one type. Then you have the mobile reactants giving rise to the mobile products, and this is a reaction. And we have also possibly permanent spectator ligands. I just emphasized the steric effect, Sutorman angle of these ligands. Now I can also look at the electronic effect. Now it also happened that depending on the nature of the alkyl groups here attached to the phosphorus, you can change the electron donation or acceptation site behavior of this phosphine. So they can be electron donor or electron acceptor, and therefore change the electron density at the nickel plus center. And this can be proved by CO, which is used in infrared. And we'll see that in some cases, this nickel becomes more charged or less charged. Now, if you do that, it weakens the nickel plus product bonding strength. And of course, this is interesting because these products here can be now removed from the coordination sphere so that the reaction can go on, and therefore one can here increase the stability of the catalyst. So here again, this is something which is very similar, even though we are on surfaces, but it can be analyzed in terms of molecular aspects. Now let's move on now to the fifth part of the talk, classification of coordination chemistries. I'm going to go To make just a summary, I'm just here, I've completed the oxidized story where I was just considering the ions and not the reduced thing. Now, you have on the two extremes the solution coordination chemistry and the solid state coordination chemistry, and in between you have interfacial coordination chemistry. So you in fact have three types of coordination chemistries, which have analogies and differences. And that is what I tried to show during the previous part of the talk. Now, this interfacial coordination chemistry can be divided again into two parts. One relates to surface framework ions, and here the reactivity, mobility, and accessibility of these transition metal ions on the surface of oxide is essentially a function of the ion location. Of course, the lower the coordination number, and the more accessible, the more reactive, and the more that's not really mobile, unless you reach the corner position where you have behavior which starts to be very similar to extra framework ions. Namely, this is the second case. This is very well documented, particularly in zeolite chemistry, when you have transitional metal ions exchanging zeolites. And here, the reactivity, mobility, and accessibility of this ion are essentially a function of the ligand pressure. And this is a drastic change from the previous case. Now, of course, borderline, which would be ions in corner position, would be rather similar. So there is no very strict barrier here, but it's a continuous evolution from behavior from this side to this side, and again from solid state to surface framework, extra framework and solution. And here again, the important thing is to realize that the oxide support can function as mono or polydentate supramolecular ligand. Now the last part of the talk is concerned with now the use of this interaction between the metal center and the surface to produce supporting network. I've just illustrated here that when it's like mushrooms, when you start to look for mushrooms, you have some problems to find one, and as soon as you find one, you can start to see the others. So when one starts to look at molecular aspects in catalysis, in interfacial coordination chemistry, one immediately sees that there are quite a number of them. For instance, during preparation, if you have something which is graphed in terms of tetraamine complex, now if you are making, by electrostatic adsorption, now if you're making the treatment in hydrogen, you can replace ammonia by hydrogen and get an hydride which is neutral and therefore very mobile. And this would give rise to very large particles. So this is something which is essentially molecular. Here again, the same thing during thermal treatment. And this is referred as to the SNSI. The surface of a reducible oxide can provide molecular species which are able to move over the metal. Here again, molecular aspect. This has been documented in a series of papers here. And again, here, the ethylene catalytic reaction that was shown several years ago by Kuhn, that small nickel particle can go to large nickel particles simply because in the CO pressure atmosphere you can produce some volatile molecular species. Now, the thing I want to show now is how can we look at this ion support interaction in positive terms. Now, if you look at the metal, it can be normally when you have small particles, you have some number of characteristics attached to them. That most of the time, it's completely reduced. The remaining ions are located at the metal support interface, and they can be looked at as a chemical glue. And they can be, in fact, there are two sides of chemical glue. They can be here framework ions, or they can be extra framework ions. And this is, it has been rather documented in Professor Zalta's laboratory over the last year, particularly in Zeolite. Now, if you have this very strongly haired particle, they usually have a low contrast and they look as wetting the support. In the next slide, I just want to show this wetting aspect. This was a slide kindly provided by Professor Jakob. You can see here it's a rhodium on titanium dioxide, and you can see that the particles are merely flowing on the surface, indicating the characteristics I just showed. Now, one can propose now to control the nucleation and growth mechanism of this small particle using a two-step procedure, where one will take advantage of different types of interaction. One can have, in fact, here in step one, for instance, ions deposited by ion exchange, a strong interaction with the support, and this would be because they are strong interaction with the support, strong ion support interaction. It's not SNSI, but it's CC. You can here, in fact, create different concentrations of nuclei, strongly paired ions at the surface of the oxide. Now, in the second step, you can now deposit, by implication, for instance, ions in weak interaction with the support. And because there is a weak interaction, there is a low reduction temperature, which will form atoms at a rather low temperature, therefore giving rise to a limited surface diffusion of these atoms. Now, this reservoir can be of the same size onto different concentration of surface size. Now, if one knows that, it means that one can, of course, distributing the same number of atoms amongst very little nuclei will give large particles. And conversely, if you have a number of nuclei, you distribute the same atoms on these many nuclei, you have smaller particles. So that overall, the weight percent of metal would be increasing when going from here to here. But the particle size will decrease. And this is the challenge we address ourselves. And the next slide shows that, indeed, if one carefully follows this procedure, one can, in fact, increase the metal content. Here, the metal content was increased by playing on the number of nuclei for the same reservoir, which was here 1.5% of nickel and silica, and here 3.5, and yet the metal particle size decreases. So it does show here that one can use, in fact, different high support interaction, bonding strengths, in positive ways. Now let's go to the conclusion. Very quickly, transition metal ions are ideal probe, as we've seen. The concept of interfacial coordination chemistry are rather unique, for instance, in the production of paper science, or they can be a combination of both solution coordination chemistry and solid-state coordination chemistry. We have started to answer, in a positive sense, the two questions raised at the beginning. And we have a better understanding of catalyst preparation. Now, I've just shown now that we could, in fact, by an a priori control of properties of supported metal particle, use these different ion support interactions in positive terms. The last slide of my talk refers now to possible directions for the future. Here, I repeat what others have already said, and I've collected available techniques to institute studies. Study particularly in catalyst preparation time-dependent phenomena, particularly as regards of the solubility of the oxide. Model the elementary steps at the molecular level of catalyst preparation. And also perform theoretical calculation to provide more solid foundation to existing models and probably evidence new directions for experimental work. And something which probably is underestimated here is a transfer and adaptation of concepts from other fields. The last slide, because it was molecular design, just shows that now if one looks into the future, this is the surface of nickel, and one has used the technique of electron tunneling microscopy to display CO molecules that are in red. And by weakening this carbon monoxide nickel bonding strength, so it can displace and attach the CO molecule at the top of the tube to place it onto the surface, so that you can reconstruct, in fact, the CO map. So you see the two eyes and the mouth here. And this is something which is obtained at 4.2 Kelvin to avoid surface diffusion. So It's a long time before we can use that as catalyst. I would like to thank the University of Pierre et Marie Curie for the financial support, CNRS, Frontwork, and Gaz de France, and also, I've forgotten the French Institute of Petroleum. So it's in fact a better advertisement. And finally, I would like to thank all the people who have participated in the laboratory to the beginning of this story. Some people have left us. Bondu is in Canada, Shang is in Leiden with Professor Ponek, and Daniel Lique is at the CNRS now. There are a number of people from the industry who are coming from our laboratory who moved to the laboratory. And finally, I would like to thank all the people from abroad, particularly Professor Ampo, Professor Direk, Giannello, Haber, Soika, with whom we have collaborated. And lately we have started a very fruitful collaboration with Gentlemen. To those people, I would like to express my gratitude. Thank you very much.
Thank you.